All right, I'm in the basement at Te Papa. This is episode L of Rakaia 1899, and I'm about to use some national treasures to illustrate the railway collision at Rakaia.
I've mentioned Frank Roberts in a previous episode because he left us his memoir of life on the footplate. And he served on the footplate in the years immediately after Rakaia. So his experiences, albeit on the Auckland section, provide us with some insight as to what life may have been like for the footplate men on the Hiranui Bluff section of railway. He also left us a collection of taonga, and I'll be using Frank's models to illustrate how the two picnic trains came together at Rakaia on that long ago Saturday evening. The U-class locomotive that Frank modelled was very definitely an American U, but it was not one of the Baldwin-built examples. Frank actually modelled the single locomotive that the railways bought from the Richmond Works in Virginia. There's a ton or two of extra weight on the Richmond example compared with U-284. That's because it was a couple of years younger than U-284. The valve system was also different, but Frank's model remains, in my view, the best three-dimensional representation we have of the Rakaia locomotives. Here we have the ubiquitous F-class that I talked about in episode D. And between them, we have the K-class of 1877. I left a gap for the N-class, which Frank didn't model, even though he did serve on that class. And it might be that he didn't model it because one night an N-class locomotive tried to kill him. And that's one of the interesting stories he tells in his book. When you line the three of the four up, it's easy to see the leap across a quarter of a century or so. And as we know from episode D, a steam locomotive is a fairly simple external combustion engine. It's also a very powerful external combustion engine, and as such, it needs to be strong and it needs to be heavy to resist all of the power that it creates at the cylinders. A locomotive also needs to be strong enough to transmit that force through to the train it's towing, as well as being able to accept the towing force if it's coupled up in a double heading situation, like was the case with the first picnic train. So we have a very heavy, very strong, and very powerful locomotive. And in the case of U-284, we can add in that the locomotive was also very fast. And on that fatal evening in Rakaia, the locomotive hauling the second picnic train made contact with the rear of the first picnic train. And in doing so, the weight and power of that locomotive, in concert with the weight and momentum of the train it was towing, came into contact with four rail vehicles that were much weaker than U-284. Those four vehicles were trapped between the second picnic train and the balance of their own train. So the collision wasn't so much like this, it was more like this. As the first picnic train tried to move out of the way of the second, and the second caught up with it. If the main line at Rakaia had been vacant that night, then the kinetic energy inherent in that second picnic train would have been converted to heat via its braking system, as I discussed back in episode F, and Charles Henry Carter would have brought his train to a stop at the water tanks located in the northern yard at Rakaia. We know, of course, that the first picnic train was occupying the main line at Rakaia. And we know that the kinetic energy that hadn't yet been converted to heat was converted to the energy that telescoped the van into carriages number 30, 29, and 28. A common feature of those vehicles was that their structural strength was contained in their underframe. And that structural strength had to achieve two things. Firstly, it had to span between the bogies of the guard's van and the bogies of the American-style carriage. and between the axles on the older style carriages. Secondly, that strength needed to accept the towing force from the locomotive and the succeeding carriages and transmit that towing force to any subsequent carriages. Also, in situations where a train might be banked from the rear, such as on a hilly section, the subfloor components needed to accept the pushing force as well as a towing force. By contrast, the walls and the front and rear bulkhead were tasked with the very simple job of holding up the roof and keeping out the weather. When compared with the forces that are exerted by being towed or being pushed, that job is peanuts by comparison. Accordingly, the wall elements and the roof elements on these carriages are exceedingly weak. And that stark difference between the strength located in the underframe and the bogies compared with the strength in the walls and roof is what allows telescoping or overriding to occur. It might be that U-284 was doing about 15 miles per hour at the point of collision. That doesn't sound much, but it's enough when we consider that each of our four vehicles was squeezed between that second picnic train of around about 240 tons all up and the balance of their own train of around about 470 tons all up. Now those weights and that speed are of course conjecture. We know the total for the second picnic train and we know the total for the first picnic train, but we do not know the ratio of bogie carriages to six-wheeled carriages. As far as speed of the second train goes at the point of collision, what we have is a speed estimate from the crew of the Methven engine that was sitting at the station limits. Their estimate is between 15 and 20 miles per hour. We also know that the first picnic train made some progress down the track. What we don't know is how fast it was going at the point of impact. And with the passing of 121 years, there's no way of knowing the weights and the speeds of those trains. What we do know is that the initial point of impact was when the locomotive of the second picnic train hit the rear of the guards van on the first train. That guards van took the full brunt of the impact, and that impact was transmitted through its frame to the American-style car. The leading buffer beam of the guards van overrides the rear buffer beam of the American-style car and drives into its rear bulkhead. It might be that that occurred because the guards van was lighter in comparison, and one of the things with the four vehicles wrecked in the collision is that the American-style car remained on the rails, whereas the others did not. And I suspect that that's because it, the American-style car, was the heaviest of the four vehicles involved. For a couple of feet, the rear of the American-style car is destroyed. But what happens is that the leading bogie of the guards van bites against the rear buffer beam of the American-style car, and the two vehicles become as one. The guards van survives relatively intact. If you had to pick between one of those four vehicles that night, I'd go with the guards van. The guard was actually on the platform at the time of collision. The only passenger in the guards van was a dog in the dog's box, and that dog survived, according to the newspapers, unscathed. We don't know who the dog belonged to, and we don't know who let it out. The rear portion of the American-style carriage is severely compromised. And even though the front compartment of the American-style carriage is largely destroyed, the next vehicle to feel the brunt of the collision is in fact the trailing of the old-style six-wheel carriages. It's lifted by the impact from the American-style car, or perhaps more correctly, the American-style car undermines the six-wheeler. That might be a better way to look at it. What happens then is that the strongest part of that six-wheeler, its rear buffer beam, plows through the upper works, the walls, and then bulkhead of the American-style car and more or less destroys that first-class compartment. At that point, that trailing six-wheel carriage is largely intact. But that's not all for the American-style carriage, and it's not all for the trailing six-wheeler, because the rear of that trailing six-wheeled carriage is lifted up, which means that its front buffer beam is lowered, which means that it too undermines the leading six-wheeled carriage, and that six-wheeled carriage is propelled up it like a ramp. It splits the side walls of the trailing six-wheeled carriage apart, and it drives the roof component of the trailing six-wheeled carriage backwards into the roof component of the American-style car, which completes the ordeal for the American-style car. So it has effectively had destruction from the rear, the front, and from above. It's no coincidence that the four fatalities that night were located in that first-class compartment of the American-style carriage, the compartment that is almost utterly destroyed. It's worth noting that I'm illustrating carriage number 28 with a four-wheeled model. That's because Frank only built one six-wheeled example, and I've used that to show carriage number 29. Carriage 29 is destroyed from the floor up for two-thirds of its length. All of the timber in its construction, all of its seats, all of its baggage, and all of its passengers were compressed from the full length of the carriage into roughly one-third of the carriage. The chances of surviving in that carriage were tending towards nil. At least that would have been the case if anyone was in it. But one of the happy flukes about that night is that carriage number 29 was so decrepit that no one rode in it. It was a horrible, wet, windy, rainy night, and reputedly, it leaked like a sieve. Carriage number 28, even though it's riding up on that ramp, survives largely intact. And carriage number 28 was full of people. If the train had been marshalled differently, so that carriage number 28, the weathertight carriage, was to the rear, and carriage number 29, the leaking carriage, was to the front, then the fatalities and injuries at Rakaia would have been significantly worse. By this stage, there's very little kinetic energy left to convert, and the remaining damage to the first picnic train is that carriages number 27 and 26 suffer broken couplings, and they're left adrift in the yard as the balance of their train moves off towards the bridge before coming to a halt in the northern yard at Rakaia. I've explained all of that in a series of steps, but in reality it happened very, very quickly. You can do the calculations yourself based on your preferred speed differential at the time of impact. But if we assume 10 miles per hour being the speed differential, then that destruction has been visited upon those four carriages in a time of less than 2 seconds. So it's over very, very quick. I'll leave the ordeal of the passengers in those carriages to another episode, but there is one feature of that night that I can illustrate with Frank's models, and that is that the rescuers started their endeavours at the leading platform and leading door of vehicle number 28. From there, the internal door between the compartments was opened, and the people in that carriage were able to be taken out to the station building. The plan from there, to the extent that one existed, was to keep moving backwards through the train. But of course, with the damage that's been described, all of the normal points of ingress and egress on those carriages had been utterly destroyed. So the rescuers cut a hole in the side of the American-style carriage. And through that, the dead and injured were removed, slowly, delicately, one by one. And the whole time, the compartment's single surviving light that had somehow found a way to survive the impact and to remain intact lit the sad and sordid scene that was very obviously a terrible railway accident and would remain the colony's worst railway disaster. Enjoy, don't enjoy, up to you. Cheers.